All right, I want to thank everyone for coming. We have been doing these meetups for a little over a year now, and super excited to see the packed room, so I appreciate everyone's support and coming to join us here. So we have a few words from our sponsors, so to say. This is a volunteer meetup, so the pizza, the beer, and the space are all made possible by those that help and support us. So Duncan, are you in the audience? Duncan, maybe you hear the mic? All right, we'll look at Duncan later. So one of our big sponsors is IBM Watson. So Watson has a large number of cognitive services, and they actually do a tremendous job with getting people onboarded. If you go to their site, there's a lot of free tutorials, and they can get you up and running to try things out very easily, all free. It's a big change from the past with IBM. I used to work with IBM and talk with them at many companies, and it was send a large number of people in, and you need a seven-figure contract to talk to Watson, so to say, and that's changed quite a lot in the last few years. So they have a lot of services that are self-serve. You can get started at free levels or very low cost levels, and it's really a great option to check out. So the other sponsor we have is ThoughtWorks. This is their space here, and they make it available not just to our meetup, but also to many other meetups. And they are also starting a newsletter to keep people informed about events and things. And they work with companies to sort of provide expert guidance in the technology space. So they're very well respected. If you've heard of Martin Fowler, if you're in engineering, Martin Fowler blogs on behalf of ThoughtWorks. So pretty exciting company there. We have three speakers today in the audio and AI space. And I think that's fantastic because we are starting to see more than just the notion of computers understanding programming. We went from programming to computers understanding text, computers understanding speech. We can keep going with the senses, and computers have a notion of visual understanding. We had a few months ago a really great talk from Clarify where they talked about how computers can start recognizing and tagging images. And we're kind of going forward with the senses to audio, and not just audio as speech to text, which has made great advances, but audio in terms of more musical information. So we're going to have a lot of different perspectives on that. So we are going to get started with Drew.
Hi, everybody. How you doing?
How's it going?
Hey.
My name is Drew Silverstein. I am the co-founder and CEO of Amper Music. Amper is an artificial intelligence composer, performer, and producer that creates unique professional music tailored to any content in a matter of seconds. And what I'd like to share with you guys tonight is the story of Amper, how we came to be, why we started it, why we think it's a very positive evolution in the creative world, in the world of music. Talk about how Amper actually works, and then show you some examples of Amper in the wild. So if that works for you guys, we'll dive right in.
Yeah.
So before starting Amper, I used to be a film composer, along with my two co-founders in LA, and we wrote music for lots of, let me move my notes over here, movies, TV shows, and video games. And in our careers, we experienced firsthand the positive effect of technological innovation on our creative process, on our ability to take an idea that we had in our head and bring it into reality. So moving from the world of magnetic tape to tools and digital, moving from digital to every mobile technology that we then had. And it was something that we felt very, very core to our ability to operate at a high level. And at the same time, we've worked with so many directors and producers and editors who would say, look, we love working with you guys, and we have time and a budget to hire you as a composer for our project. But for so much of the content we create, we have neither of those two things. And instead, we've got to deliver it
closer. All right, wow, this makes a difference. I'm gonna start over, just kidding. Thank you. So instead, they'd say, look, we don't have the time, we don't have the budget to hire you guys. We typically have to license music, or license stock music, and they say we hate that, right? You've got to search for the music, you've got to jump through legal and financial hoops. It's not creative, it's not personalized, it's not customized, etc. We've since learned that no one likes stock music in the world.
And so they'd say, could you write the music for us instead? And more often than not, we'd say, look, we wish we could, but the economics don't work for us to go from a boutique film music studio to kind of mass content creation house. At some point, I was supposed to change his life, so we'll do it right now. This is why stock music sucks. And you know, they were disappointed because we said, we can't do this for you. But we said, look, we are experts at translating emotion into music and music into emotion. So if we could build a creative AI that gives you the same collaborative experience of working with the composer within the time and economic framework of functional music, would you want it? And overwhelmingly, their answer was yes. And so we said, great, we're not sure it's actually possible, but we'll give it a shot. Because as many of you may know in the room, computer music is not a new idea. I mean, it's been around for as long as computers have been around, and algorithmic music for centuries before that. But it had never really been commercially successful. And so, again, this is why stock music sucks, because we're still looking for the music. So we put our heads together, Sam, Michael, and I, and ended up coming up with a pretty novel technological and philosophical approach to the problem, which I'll get into in a little bit. And we built Amper, which looks like this. Now, our goal at Amper, on a broad level, is to enable the creative expression through music for anyone around the world, regardless of their musical background, their financial ability to spend money on tools and software, or their access to mentorship and training. And what this means is for non-musical creators who are making content, whether you're a video editor or a game designer or making some podcast, right, you typically have a creative idea. You know what you're trying to achieve, and music might be an important part of that process. But you lack the ability to express that music yourself as a user for music. And what we aim to do is for the non-musical content creators to be their end-to-end functional solution, almost as if we are their expression tool, to say, you know what you want, describe that to Amber in a way that's natural to you, and let us help bring your vision to reality. Let's help translate your creative idea into a musical reality. And then for musicians and artists and composers who are already creating music and already expressing themselves creatively, we say, you use technology every single day to help further your process. Again, as a composer, we live this life. But there's a lot of the creative process that has nothing to do with creativity, right? Where we've got to form it, we've got to version, we've got to go back and check our work. And there are times even when it's helpful to have a collaborator to bounce ideas off of, to flesh things out. And so we say to these individuals, use Amper as a collaborative tool to help you further your existing creativity, help you increase your productivity, increase your efficiency, and hopefully make better music. So what does this mean for people? In a nutshell, it means that the world of tomorrow and music is going to be very different than the world today. And to help explain that, I'm going to kind of dive into how we view the world at Amper. We see two types of media music, one functional and one artistic. Functional music we define as music that's valued for its use case, where we don't really care how it was made or how the collaboration or creativity that went into making it. And when we care what it's doing, we don't care where it came from. Functional music. As a great example, with elevator music. Right? You standing in the elevator or the person who decided what music's going to go in there didn't think about and doesn't value the fact that someone spent however long writing this music and that they worked with this person, and that all you want to know is this going to keep me entertained and peaceful when I arrive from the ground floor of the sixth floor? That's functional music. Separately, we have artistic music. And artistic music we define as music that's valued for the collaboration and the creativity that goes into making it. It's not as much about the use case, but about the creative process. And so, if you think about John Williams and Steven Spielberg, you're on the screen. Right? When they sat down together to collaborate and create the first score for Star Wars, right, it wasn't necessarily the end product that was the goal. It was the collaborative process. A person working with another person, collaborating to make art. And art is something that we inherently value as people. It's something that makes our society what it is. So if you are a content creator in the world who previously needed to search and find kind of satisfactory functional music, Amper is now kind of the end-to-end solution for you, and that means if you used to make functional music and try to sell it at the low-hanging fruit, we're gonna kind of go toe-to-toe with you, and we're gonna say, be better. Raise the bar on what it means to be artistic and what it means to be creative. And if you are an artist and if you're focusing on that artistic music, we're gonna say, you have nothing to worry about, because artistry and the value of human creation, human creativity, will never go away, even when music, when Amper's music is indistinguishable from that of human created music. And that, by the way, is an inevitability. To anyone in the room who disagrees, and I'm sure there are some, I would argue that provided humanity still exists in 10,000 years, provided we exist in 3 months at this rate, but if we exist in 10,000 years, most of the time, we can agree that computers will probably have advanced to the point where computer-made music will rival that of human-created music. And if we can agree on that point, and if not, I'm happy to talk afterwards, but if we can agree, then what we're talking about is when, not if. Right? If we say at some time horizon this will happen, then we just have to find out, well, do you think it's going to happen in a week, in a year, in a decade, or a century? That ever we think is, you know, right around the corner. But in this scenario, where music is indistinguishable from human-created music, again, I want to drive this point home, because this is often what happens when people say, well, what are you going to do to people? Is everyone going to be out of work? If you write really shitty music, yeah, you will probably have to change your job. Sorry. That's the world, that's the definition of technological innovation, is it forces people to be better. But if you focus on music as an artistic and creative part of what you're doing, you'll always have a place in society. And a great example, I think I'm supposed to change the slide here, is Mona Lisa. We look at the painting on the left, painting on the right. One of these, if we first look at them right now, and I see these are both the original copy, everyone says, great, it's priceless. If I say one of them is the original artwork painted by Da Vinci, and one of them is a perfect reproduction painted by my cousin, right? Instantly the value changes dramatically, right? It's the exact same thing. Let's say you can't tell a difference. But because we know one was painted by an artist centuries ago, and we value that process that he went through to come up with the idea to paint, to translate his artistic vision into reality, and we know another was just the job of a great copycat, right? One is priceless and one is worth $19.99 at the bookstore. Same piece of indistinguishable content, of artwork, valued very differently because one is artistic and one is functional. And so, the likely results of all of this, let's say the future that I see happen, for the sake of our investors, I hope that's the case. One, it means billions of individuals around the world who previously lacked the ability to express themselves creatively through music, gain a new set of tools to do so. Two, it means artistic composers, people who create music valued for its artistry, gain a brand new set of technology to further their existing music making. Right? At one point it was pencil and paper, then it became magnetic tape, then it became digital, and now it's becoming AI. And three, if you write functional music and your functional music happens to be really bad, we're going to challenge you to be better. We're going to raise the bar on what it takes to deliver value to customers, and we're going to say you need to evolve. You need to move forward. And with these three things, if we think of adding billions of people around the world back into the creative class, we think of giving existing artists exponentially more capability, and if we think of raising the bar for anybody else, you know, we think that creative AI as a whole, and Amper certainly is a part of it, will welcome in, you know, quite possibly the greatest creative revolution in our history by the amount of positive effect it will have on society. And so now we'll get to the fun part. I'm going to show you how it works. This slide I should have gone to at some point. It was a cool picture. Cool. So Amber is a creative brain in the cloud. It's accessible via web app, via an API, via a panel in Premiere Pro. I'll show you the web app today, which is geared toward video editors, producers, anyone else who deals with video on a regular basis. And totally live demo. At its core, if you know nothing about music, Amber asks you for three things: the style of music you want to create, the mood you want to convey, and the length of the track. And so, if we, and we can do this all day around, I'll be around afterwards, if you want to play it for yourself, awesome. But let's say we're going to make cinematic music. And then you have to describe what mood you want that music to convey. So say epic and driving, and then decide how long you want this to be. So I'm just going to pick a number, and say go. Now I say, Amber, please create a unique, professional piece of music tailored to my preferences. That's epic, driving, cinematic, and 17 seconds long. And again, we're not using loops, we're not using licensed material. This is being created note by note from scratch, from our own proprietary sample libraries, which are recorded by the world's best musicians and studios around the world. And in a matter of seconds, Amber made this. And what we'll do just for the sake of fun is we'll look to the professional workflow where you've got more control. Is Amper's not a black box neural network. It's actually a contextually aware creative AI, which means you can give it feedback. You can iterate with it as if you're sitting in a room with a composer. And so, let's do that. All right, we might hop in there and say, you know what? As a broad level, I hated the rhythm, so change that, please. And in fact, you know, music is subjective, and so I want to reorchestrate this thing, right? We have a, you know, presets in terms of bands you might want to use, but if you want to get really specific and start talking about instrumentation, you're welcome to. So I hated that guitar, I'd rather have this one. Music is subjective, and that's one of the beauties of music, also why it's so hard to build an AI that is successful. Because where neural nets are most successful and where data science can really be effective is when you're trying to solve for an objective question, right? Where there's an objective answer. Do I have cancer? Is this a dog? Right? Things where no matter what your preference might be, there's an answer. In music, what's great about it is there is no right answer. We all in the same room might listen to the exact same piece of music, and you love it, and I hate it, and you think it's the weirdest thing you've ever heard since the Beatles, right? And no one's wrong or right. Which is fantastic, but it's what makes music so incredible, but it also makes it incredibly difficult to make something that we just know from the get-go that it's going to be right. So let's say, as an example, I said, you know what, that was fine, but I wish epic driving music was faster. We'll change that. And you know what, that was not the right length whatsoever. We're going to have to shorten this guy. Thank you, ThoughtWorks Internet. Right, and you know what? Something happened at the end, so we want to accent some cool moment because if we were syncing this to picture, there's a reason to do so. So we say, Amber, go. And Amber's gonna say, all right, so I made a piece of music for you. You liked part of it, but you obviously didn't like the rhythmic approach to this piece of music. You didn't like the instrumentation, so I'll let the reorchestrate it. We're gonna shorten it. So we're going to have to rethink music and time. We sped up the tempo, which means we actually have to write a different amount of music to fit in the same space. And by the way, you wanted to accent that moment, you know, 1.5 seconds from the end. And this is a very similar conversation that I might have with a director or a producer talking about a film. They're going to give kind of this musical but not necessarily musically specific feedback. But Amber says, okay, great, we'll take that. And that first piece of music turned into this. Just like that. And obviously once I'm done, I'm able to download the music and I get a royalty-free global and perpetual license to use it. Because we want an Amper to allow you to do whatever you want with your creative content and not feel pinched by, you know, the exact same legal and financial hoops that you hate about everything else. So that's a quick example of Amper. Again, if you want to play around with it, it's free to access for personal use at ampermusic.com. I'm also happy to let you play with it on my computer afterwards. But now I'll talk about how Amper actually works. Like, what's under the hood? So as I mentioned, one of the things I'm really proud of is that while we recognize the value of crunching data and trying to come up with a polynomial that reflects that data and neural networks and existing statistical analysis, we've taken a very different approach in Amper. We said, can we teach computers to be intrinsically creative? And can we enable machines to convey and express this creativity through music? And practically what that means is, can we understand, can we define what emotion means? Why, if I say, epic driving, do you feel epic and do you feel driving? We all inherently know what that means, we feel it. But how do we describe that? What are the metaphysical, what are the biological, what are the just general descriptors that we would go into making it? And how can we teach a machine to inherently know what that means? And know that it's different for every single person. And so let's say we've solved for that. Let's say I just, in my gut, I know what it means. And then we say, well, we want to express this in a cinematic way. And we want to express this in some particular style. Then we've got to kind of put our composer hat on and say, well, what do we do to translate this mood, this emotion, into music? Why do we use certain instruments? How do those instruments play? What do they do in concert with others? If I change one thing, does it change the rest of the piece? And so by teaching computers to understand emotion, and then teaching computers to express that emotion through music, while being contextually aware of why they're making every decision, so they can go back and change it when you don't like it, when you want to personalize the music, we're able to build Amber. And then, at its core, if we kind of go one step less bullshit, then we see three parts of Amber. There is the performer, the composer, and the producer. And that really reflects the three parts of a composer's process, right? You're gonna write a piece of sheet music, you're going to record it, and then you're gonna mix and produce it. And so with Amber, in a couple seconds in the cloud, it writes a piece of sheet music. Then we use our proprietary sample library to stitch together millions and millions of audio files and come up with a recording that we hope sounds real. And then we've got to mix and produce it. And what's important is that all three of these elements are successful, because they're very much three legs of a stool. If you ask for something and I write it well and I mix it well but it was recorded poorly, you're going to be unhappy.
Is this an end-to-end network, or is it three separate sequences?
It's one giant thing bundled together. If you ask me, is this an end-to-end thing, or is it one sequence together? It's one process that happens, but it's kind of how we divide and how we think about it. If you ask me for something, and I write it poorly, but it's recorded great and it's mixed well, you're still going to be unhappy. And if you ask me something, and I write it well, and I perform it well, but it's mixed poorly, you're also unhappy. So all three of these elements, composition, performance, and production, all have to be successful. And with that, let's talk about how Amper actually gets used. As I mentioned, we love working with both non-musical content creators who need music as an end-to-end solution, and with artists and musicians. And one of the uses of Amper that we were most excited about a couple months ago was an artist named Terrence Hunter, who had an idea that she wanted to make a pop album solely with AI. She has great musical instincts, but has her limitations, and had a compelling enough vision that she searched for a tool and ended up using Amper. And I'll play part of the song first, And then I'll talk about how she actually used it. This is a song called Break Free from his album.
I wish I could see beyond what I can see. I wish I could touch beyond what I can touch. I wish I could feel beyond what isn't real. I wish I could imagine, yeah. There's more to who we are.
If you want to hear the rest of the song, search for Taryn Southern online. And we don't want the free update to Keynote. What's great about this is Taryn is an artist. She was able to sing, she had a melody, she had lyrics that she wrote, but to her own admission, you know, she can't play every instrument in the orchestra. And she doesn't know how to mix and record and produce the music to the level. And so she worked with Amber and ended up expressing kind of the ideas she wanted. She collaborated, this is good, this is not good, this is the part of this piece I like, this is the part of that piece I like, and ultimately used the combination of her artistic intention with very powerful technology that helps her bring her vision to life to make this song. And to be clear, the vocal and the lyrics were completely done by Taryn, and all of the underlying music was made by Amber. So it's really the combination of artist and technology to move the world of creative expression forward. Then on the exact other end of the spectrum, there's a company named Mental Floss, which makes a lot of social media videos, right? And they're creating, you know, 10 videos a day that teach you how to hold a nail on a hammer. And this is a use case where they say, look, we need an end-to-end solution because we have 3 minutes to make this video, pop it online, and we don't want to search for music, and this is what they do. Well, we'll go back. And so again, very different use case, very different product, but it's still a person with a creative idea who wanted to express that using music. And as a last example, we think of reporters who often do kind of highlight videos and sports things, and this is a video that a customer made to highlight a high school football game. And so this high school touchdown run became really thrilling. And it made the kid really happy that his video looked like it was from ESPN. And so what I hope to be able to share with you guys is one, why we started building Amber, how we got into it, why we don't think it's the end of the world, but rather think it's the beginning of a fantastic new era in creativity and in creative expression. How we actually build the thing without getting too technical, and examples of Amber in the wild. So either now or afterwards, I'm happy to answer any questions and happy to go as deeply as you'd like to go. But thank you all for letting me share this with you, and you've been a fantastic audience. Thank you.
Maybe just talk a little bit more about training the network, you know, in the beginning.
Yeah, sure. So what we don't do, and that'll kind of help, we'll solve by doing one minus X. What we don't do is just say, here's a giant data set, run it through a neural network, here's the output. Again, while that might give us an answer, the process of doing so is inherently a black box. We don't know why the decisions that were made. So as soon as I try to go back and say, well, I didn't like this and I wanted to do that, and could you change that thing you did, there's no contextual awareness to do so. So what we had to do is very much differently. I will answer you next. You will ask your hand. But good job for being persistent. So what we had to do is basically say, how do we build a system that can give us the musical result of understanding creativity, of making a piece of music as if it had looked at a giant set of data, but where it still knows why it did what it did, right? So in every 30-second piece of music, Amper makes about a million decisions. And Amper knows why it made every one of those million decisions, so that when we realize that you hate cowbell, right, and you love really fast music, and as deeply as we want to go for kind of preferences, Amper says, okay, cool, I get that. Let's go back and iterate, let's change that. Let me learn why you like what you like, and create music that's contextually aware, as if, you know, we had sat in a room and collaborated for 20 years, right? Where we walk in and I'm like, oh, hey, how you doing? This is what we're gonna do because I know you, right? And we wanna build that same creative and collaborative relationship through an AI. Yes, sir?
Okay, can you transpose this, no pun intended, to different cultures? Because not all cultures perceive a minor key as dramatic or sad.
Great question. The question was, can you transpose Amper to different cultures? Because not all cultures perceive a minor key as sad. One of the beauties of music is that it is somewhat universal. And while the description that we put on music might be different, the underlying music is still the same. And that's part of why, when we talk about music being subjective, it becomes so important that we recognize that. Because you, sir, might think music minor key is really sad, and you might say, you know what, that actually makes me really happy, because it does. And that's okay, there's no wrong answer. And so the challenge then is not necessarily can we write music that is in a minor key, but can we identify how you as a user relate to that minor music. Do you call that sad, do you call that happy, do you call that exciting? And if we can bridge that gap, the gap of understanding, then we can write music that's best for you. Yes, ma'am.
You said it creates unique music for every user. And like if like two users put like same input, like the first three inputs, then would that make inputs same?
Sure. So the question is, does Amper make unique music every single time, even if we push the same inputs? The answer is yes. Amper makes unique music every single time. If you want to press rewrite forever, you'll always get a brand new piece of music. And where the interesting challenge comes up is we want to both make a new piece of music, but we also want to recognize the things you've asked it to do. So if you ask for a piece of classic rock music, you're probably going to get an electric guitar, because that's kind of part of the zeitgeist of the genre. But it's still going to be a brand new piece of music. And one of the analogies that I think conveys this effectively is when we think of top 40 radio, right? They're all distinctly different songs, but they're all very clearly top 40 radio because they share enough commonality to be associated together, but we also recognize them as distinctly different pieces of music.
Yeah, one more question.
Wait, I've got to get back to you on that. Most of top 40 radio is programmed with programs like Profit, where they work the clock, you have tempo, key, and speed, and your heart breaks. So please consider that. Because what we hear on commercial radio now is programmed. It's not a PD saying, oh, let's go for a lively tune.
Sure. Thank you for sharing that. Appreciate it. Last question.
What are the elemental building blocks? Like, is it possible basically to transcribe a piece that you compose here? Like, does it output that, or is it that?
Yeah. So the question is, what are the elemental building blocks of music we make? Because we're making music out of thin air, we're writing it note by note. We are using our own proprietary sample libraries, right? So we'll go into studios around the world, record every instrument, every note thousands of times, every volume, articulation, note, dynamic, every possible way you would ever play a note of any instrument. And then, you know, we end up with 100,000 samples of a piano, right? And then because of that, no matter how we write music for the piano, we could probably create a performance by stitching together all these thousands of audio files that sounds like it was this piece of music created organically. And then from there, we've got to mix and master the music. And so if we want to spit out sheet music, great. If you want to give you a MIDI file, sure. Because it's done at such a granular level that the output format is really dependent on what a user wants and not limited by our lowest common denominator. So I'll be around afterwards if you want to take any more questions, but thank you all again. Really appreciate it and delighted to be here. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having me. My name is Gal Klein. I'm the CTO and co-founder of Audioburst. And after this amazing presentation we just had with Amber, I'm going to talk about something different about audio, which is talk audio. So we all know audio is music, and we all love to listen to music, but audio started as talk. Radio first was aired with talk, with news, with people talking to each other and conveying ideas. And that seems to be something that happened and people forgot about it. You can search on Google for images, you can search for text, you can search for videos. Talk audio? No, you can't search anything for that until now. Basically, amazing content is produced every day by great professionals on the radio, and it just fades away. It's gone. It's not there anymore. And it's sad because there are huge ideas, funny moments, emotional moments, and I'll dive into these later, but these are all gone and are not reachable anymore. And even though podcasts are getting bigger and bigger, these are long types of content that you like to listen to, but then again, very hard to find exactly that point in time that you enjoy. So we're in an era where hands-free, eyes-free devices, Alexa was mentioned, we have one here, we'll show that in a second, are getting more and more traction, and what's best than audio to go and answer your question, give you your information. And as amazing work that Amazon, Google, and Microsoft are doing with making that Alexa sound human, it does not reflect emotion. And Amber discussed about emotions, and we discussed about emotion, because audio is all about emotions. And the ideas reflected by humans with their voice, or with their, well, with their voice, if they're singing a song or if they're telling you a story, is very, very important. So, search is not there, or is it? It's there, and that's what Audioburst is doing, and I'll explain a little bit more. So, talk audio. What's important about talk audio? It's entertaining, okay? There are funny, there are pranks, there are things that people say and you love to hear again and again, and they're also very informational. So, when you hear someone talking about the radio, basically they want to convey some kind of an idea. They want to tell you a story. It could be a long story, it could be a short story, and I'll leave the presentation to someone called Amy Webb, who just did a month ago a conference on, it's called the Online News Association Conference, and we've never spoke with her, but she found this very interesting. So I'll give her 5 minutes to present the idea of informational audio, and then I'll continue. Can you hear?
So those are voice interfaces, generative algorithms, audio search, and machine reading comprehension. And the question that I want you to think through, which is again a really basic, simple question, but I want you to think about this in a new way, is why should journalists, why should every single person in this room care about the future of voice interfaces in a critical way? So, we now have deep learning for machine reading comprehension. So this is the same thing as you reading a book and being able to tell me afterwards, not just read it and recite it, but tell me afterwards what it is that you've read and to extract some meaning out of it. So on Google, I typed this into search. Can you take guns into a hotel in Las Vegas? And the search return was this, right? So it's a whole bunch of links. And it's linked to news stories, it's linked to TripAdvisor, it's just a bunch of URLs, which is what it's supposed to do, okay? But it doesn't really get me the answer to that question. Now, there are cases in our search engines where we semantic search is in play and we can ask a question like, how old is Will Wheaton? And we will immediately get to the answer, but we're not quite there yet with the rest of our information. However, one of the links, one of the many, many, many links that I found, took me to this story, which is a great story, and from NPR, and once I read all the way through that story, pretty far down, I finally did get to my answer. But there were a lot of steps that were required by me, the consumer. So that takes me to what's happening at Microsoft and Stanford. They are doing an entirely huge body of work on machine reading comprehension research, And the idea here is to take us from asking that question to getting us immediately the answer. Here's why this is important. Because machine reading comprehension is what lays the groundwork for our future conversations with machines, right? If we were to ask that same question to Alexa, and Alexa just starts reading me back random answers, that's not useful. So everybody who's working on voice is also working on machine reading comprehension. And I want to give you, I want to show you something that just launched. It's called Audioburst. Has anybody tried Audioburst first yet? Wow, losing my ability to talk. Okay, so Audioburst is a living example of MRC in play now within the news world. And what's interesting is that news organizations don't seem to know that this is working just yet. So I asked the same question. Can you take guns into hotel rooms in Las Vegas? And what it did was it went through, it's not cataloging all audio stories, radio stories, it's got a few, but it went through everything very, very quickly, read through the transcripts of all of those stories, and then didn't give me a list of information where I can get the answer. Instead, it just gave me the information. Okay, so this is, and I did this on the web.
The suitcase has nearly 24 guns into his room on the 32nd floor.
So this goes sort of on and on, but it explains the answer to that. And it was coming from WGN. But this also works on Alexa. So there's an Alexa skill, and what this allowed me to do standing in my kitchen was to ask the same question, and instead of having some possible answers or news sources, it just told me the answer.
Alexa, ask Newsfeed if I can take guns into hotel rooms in Las Vegas.
Takes a while.
So I'll skip that because we're going to have a lot of samples afterwards. But this was a presentation of someone who understood the, and we did not talk with her before that, but understood the meaning of audio and how important it is to have some kind of indexing and some kind of reading comprehension. And it needs to be automatic because the amount of content that is being created every second by all radio station podcasts out there is enormous. And to index everything is, well, it's not like indexing the whole web, but it's pretty damn big. So let's talk about what needs to happen in order to do that task of indexing and answering your question. So there's basically two sides of that. First of all, there are tons of sources. There are videos, there are podcasts, there are radio stations. All of them are sending you data over the air or over the internet, and you need to go understand, break it down into small bursts, segmented. Because you don't want to hear the whole hour. You want just that piece of information that is important for you. So you have to take that, create these 1 to 3 minutes burst, okay? We call them bursts, these audio clips, and put them in a repository. Okay, that's part number one of the need. The second part is when you're asking a question, when you have a need, the question could be a very precise or just tell me what the news is. Okay, I have to understand why are you asking that question. I need to understand what is the story that you're looking for and go through that repository and bring you the best answer. That's the basic two sides of the flow. First, build your database. Second, serve it in a smart way. Unlike Google, where you get 10 results and you usually pick one, okay, and everybody's, you know, remember the I feel lucky, which went away because even Google couldn't make the first answer right. Here, you don't have that prerogative. When someone's talking to Alexa, they will not go through 10 results, listen to 10 pieces of audio, and find the one that they're looking for. You need to get it right, let's say, the first or three times, three first answers. So we talked about creating these short types of bursts. Let's talk about what are these bursts and how can you create these bursts using an AI. So there are different types of segmentations. I'll deep dive into one of them, but basically an audio piece can be composed of a lot of topics. So think about like a news show that they talk about politics and then sports and then another thing in sports and then back to politics and then world news. All these are topics and they're changing. So if I can understand when one topic started and the other topic ended, I can go and create these little bursts. They're still not good as an answer because I can do a story about NBA, but you want a specific team, okay? But you need to have that type of topical segmentation. Second is take a book review. There's a podcast about books. They take a book and they talk an hour and a half about that book. There's no different topics. It's a whole 1 hour and a half talking about that book with the author. The way to segment that is to what we call chapterizing, taking that and making that into a listening experience that you can actually consume if you don't have an hour and a half. So this, to smartly decide where that's a good stop. I'll continue later. If I have an hour and a half, sure, why not? But if I don't, and usually I don't, I want to listen to short little segments, chapters of that episode and not have to listen and remember where I stopped the last time. Music shows. A lot of stuff is going on in a music show. There's plenty of music, songs, produced or done by an AI, but there's a lot of very important information. There's a concert. There are tickets for concerts. There's some gossip about that musician. A lot of very, very cool stuff happening, like Ryan Seacrest stuff. A lot of very cool stuff happening between these songs, and you need to take all the music out, not the way some of the companies are trying to take music in. We're taking all the music out and trying to find these important things, and that's what we put in the repository. And the last one is interviews. If you have a show about interviews, you have questions and answers. It will be best if you have the question together with the answer, and then you can search for a question. You see someone asks the same questions to someone that you know, that you're happy to listen to, okay? And you can get the question and the answer. So we're here on an AI meetup, so I'll try to be technical a little bit and understand how we do topical segmentation. So in order to segment the topic, you have to teach the AI to be smart. And how do you get smart? You read. If you want to know if you're a good student and you want to be very successful, go read all the information that you have on that specific topic. So our AI goes and reads all the online newspapers, all the online CNN and all the Google News and everything. And basically on each topic reads everything that is happening right now on this topic. It could be entertainment, it could be sports, it could be a game. It knows exactly what's happening right now on each topic. And it knows because there are terms in a topic that could now reside as a sport. Like LeBron James just scored a zillion points in a game. If you're asking about LeBron James, then you're talking about sports. Next day, he went to a party, got drunk, and hit someone. Now LeBron James has nothing to do with sports. It's entertainment or gossip or news, you call it. But you have to always understand that now, right now, things change all the time, okay? And there are ideas and people and brands and names that cover more than just one topic. So you always have to, you know, put your finger and understand what's happening on a specific topic. And you need to make sure that you're understanding what are the important stuff and what are not important. What words really signify that topic and what words just, you know, happen to be there. How close are they to the idea and how far away? It's called vectors and distances. I don't go too technical, but that's basically it. One more very, very important thing and very hard thing to do is understanding trending. There's a new name now coming up. It was never mentioned. It could be a hurricane, Irma, or it could be someone who was not mentioned on the news, like Kevin Spacey, who's a very known name, but he was not mentioned on the news for years. Okay? Suddenly he's trending, and you want to understand that he is now a very important figure because he's mentioned so many times. Know that this is something trending. This is something important. This is something that you have to understand and know. So here's a piece of text that comes out of a machine transcription. Of course, this is not English, but just to let you know, this is how the AI looks at stuff, okay? Because when you're running audio through a speech-to-text engine, even the best speech engines, when you talk about radio, where people are talking one at the other and the quality is bad, and the results are crap. Okay, well, not crap, but not as good as you want to. And we have our own speech engine, and we teach it, and we train it, and we do amazing stuff. And we're really, really proud of what we did. This is not foolproof. So if I would have asked you to go and segment this and cut it into two pieces, do you think you could do that? So let's see what the engine does. The engine picked up very important keys and words and trending topics and bigrams and stuff from it's learning. He just read a lot of stuff. He's very smart right now. So he starts working things up, and you can see the things in red and things in blue, and you start to see a pattern. And if you look at the things in blue, you see Premier League, and you see Burnley, and you see Norwich City. And if you have any idea what soccer is, then you start to understand that the lower pieces has something to do with sport soccer, and the other is, I don't know, something about worldviews. So basically, you can start finding out where one topic started and one topic ended, but there are holes in the middle. And these holes are very hard to understand where exactly the topic ended. And for that, we do something very smart, is by extracting not just the text, but a lot of audio cues out of that. So if there's a pause, if there's a hesitation, if there's laughter, if there's music, if there's silence, whatever audio cue you can think of, we're trying to pull that out. If there are differences in the sound, okay, so it's an interview and the other guy's on the phone, so you can basically see the differences in the sound. Or if now we went from the studio to the on-field reporter. So all these cues help us understand exactly where to cut and find out that we have now a burst about news, US politics. Yes?
I'm sorry, I'm kind of confused because you are talking about before something like a topic modeling, like about text. But I understand right now it's like you put like some audio research online, found some word, like for example, sport, and you got like a text and audio, and then you use some Microsoft API, for example, and you translate the audio into the text, and then you classify that.
Okay, so she talks about the flow, I'll explain the flow. We take the audio piece live and we transcribe it using speech to text. We also extract audio cues. So now we have a bunch of text, okay, which was that, okay, and some audio cues. Before that, okay, in an ongoing basis, the engine went and saw, what is sport? Let's read all the sport magazine and understand what are the most important things in the sports, especially sports soccer. So I have that in my head, in my AI logic. Then when I take that transcript that was pulled out of the speech to text, I go and analyze that, and I'm analyzing that every few words that are added. So this is all happening live, okay? I'm analyzing that text and trying to find patterns or blocks of text that are talking about the same topic. Then I take these blocks and I fix them by the audio cues, trying to find exactly where one started and one ended. And now I can say that this point, I can cut it, say this is a burst about that specific, and put it in my repository. There are, I do a bunch of other things. I do keyword extraction and entity extraction, and I add a title and I add some, but that's not very important for now.
So you have your own machine to translate, or you have like a call API?
We have our own.
Okay.
Okay? So, that was part one. I have now a repository of bursts that were on a specific topic. Okay, I'm getting a bit technical because I want you to understand how you build an AI that understands stuff. Okay, so I'll be happy to answer questions later. But second part is now understanding me. I'm the user. I need to get you from my huge repository the best answer to match your questions. And it's just like creating the best ramen soup in the world. You have to have very good ingredients, but you have to take from each ingredient the exact amount of stuff to make the whole thing come together. So when a user asks a question, I need to understand why are they asking the question? What happened in the world right now? Why are they asking it this question specifically right now? What are the sources? What if you're asking something about sports, I'm not gonna search in content that was not sport or was not intended to be sport. So there's a lot of things that I do first about understanding your intent, okay? And when I have all that, okay, I can go ahead and scan all my content, all the bursts that I created, recut them live, meaning I'll take, I had a 3-minute burst about, you know, politics, but you asked about something that has to do with tax reform, I'll take just that, because I know what tax reform means. I know who talks about tax reform. I know which persons are discussed when they're talking about tax reform. And then I'll recut them, I'll choose from all the bursts that I have, because I have a lot, okay? What do you prefer? You like to listen to male people, you like to listen to female voices, you like these sources more. This is an ongoing process. This will take us more time than we currently have, because this is all new. So learning user preferences will take us some time, but we have started analyzing some of that data and fine-tuning that, because I have a lot of answers to give. Let's give you the best ones, okay? And we use a lot of machine learning to do that and understand what people like and running models on top of that. And basically give you that specific answer and play that to you on the device that you chose to listen to. Sometimes it's just not, it's not one answer, sometimes it's a playlist. I want to hear the news. So what type of news do you like to hear? Do you like to hear the sports first? Do you like to hear weather first? Right. To cover it all, on one end, we're listening, we're segmenting, we're indexing that content. And on the other, we're interacting with user. They understand what they want. We learn their personality and what their listening identity is. And then we can serve and provide that solution. So a little bit about Audioburst. We're now accessible through API. We're accessible through our website, which does a different type of search. It's more a web-based kind of search. It indexes content for Google to go and index and get, bring it back. But we're also on Amazon Alexa, Google Home Assistant, Cortana, and InfoCard systems. And I'll just showcase what that means right now. So I have an Alexa here. And let's pray to the demagogues gods and do that. Let's start with Alexa. Alexa, what happened in Texas?
Here's your flash briefing. Ryan Seacrest does not contain any recent content at the moment.
Alexa, stop. Okay. So I have Ryan Seacrest as my, that's the response that I get. Let's try something better, which is Newsfeed, our skill on Alexa. Alexa, ask Newsfeed what happened in Texas.
Aired 3 hours ago. On AM 570, the mission.
A shooting in Sutherland Springs, Texas, the First Baptist Church there. Some new details that they're continuing to make available now. Nearly half of the dead are considered to be children under the age of 15.
Alexa, stop. So, okay, sorry about the sad story, but it does talk, it does showcase very much. Alexa,
I found the
stop.
Stop. Thank you for using the news feed by Audioburst. We hope to hear from you soon.
So basically you heard the emotional feeling by the presenter about that sad story. And that will never happen with a news bulletin or headline or Alexa reading the headline. And that's very important. I think in the previous Amper presentation, in my presentation, and I'm sure the next presentation, emotion and audio are very entwined together. And that's something very important, and we see that as a standard. But let's just search this other stuff. Then I'll just pull on Google News and see what's interesting. So we'll go through a little demo. For something in the business world. Alexa, ask Newsfeed, what's the latest on Apple taxes?
Aired on Sunday, November 5th, 6 p.m. on Reveal.
This is Michael Montgomery again. While the debate over taxes plays out before cameras on Capitol Hill, the inside story of how corporations save billions in taxes has been mostly hidden from public view. That is, until now. One of the biggest revelations comes from Apple, America's most profitable company. In 2013, the Senate called out Apple
Alexa.
For avoiding taxes
Alexa.
By using Irish
Alexa.
Subsidiaries.
Stop.
Thank you for using Newsfeed by Audioburst.
So,
we hope to hear from
thank
you soon.
So, my apologies for getting it right. But important thing is to know that these devices are very new, okay? They're not yet built for that specific engagement. Currently on Alexa, there's you can only play up to a minute and a half of audio if you want it to be interactive. Some others are doing 2 minutes. You're gonna do a session, if you're going to the bot session, you're gonna learn something about something called SSML, which is a language that all the bots understand about how to speak text and how to speak audio, and it has the limitations, but my microphone is not working. Right? Yeah, so I'll speak. Yeah, okay. So I raised my voice a little bit. But that type of, you can't play, on Alexa, you can't play one after another, you can't create a playlist, you have to say next after each person. But that's just a beginning. Everything will be, we'll talk more to machines, and we'll have, we hope, a very good AI that will respond back to us with questions to our answers. I'm here if you have any questions here, now or later. Hope that was informational. Yes?
I'm curious how you mentioned that it would tune in to user preferences, like whether they like to hear like sort of story from like men or women on a particular topic. Are you concerned about creating an echo chamber from that? And like if you have thought about it, how you thought of combating that?
Okay. So one of the things that influenced me a lot while doing that was a TED Talk that showed, you remember a few years ago there was riots in Egypt, and someone went on a TED Talk and showed two screens of Google, and they asked Egypt on both, and one did not show anything about that, only showed tourist and TripAdvisor stuff, and the other just showed a lot of news. And that's what makes Google a very disturbing editor for your content, because you're not getting the real news. It's not opening the world of web, it's closing it down. We take first, our first duty is to give you a very good response to your question. Then if I have two or three that match that score on the quality and data side, then I can play with this, with that. Then I can try and make, okay, this is a more trusty source from you, and that is a less trusty source from you. But the quality of the response and the accuracy of the content comes first. If you try the news feed about things that are not currently in the news, you will see that we try very hard to find an answer. It's not always a good answer because it was not mentioned. We lose context. But we don't fool you into giving you something you like just to make you happy. And that's a flaw, because you're not getting a very good experience when you're asking. But we want this to, because news feed is for news, we're doing our best to give you the best news right now about something. So if you ask about Texas 3 days ago, you might get something about something there where Texas was mentioned and not a very good outcome. Yes?
You walked us through how you separate topics.
Yes.
You also mentioned that you separate by chapter, I think, longer pieces.
Yeah.
Is that a similar process, or does it work differently?
It works much differently. It works on, I didn't have all the, audio cues play a much bigger role, and we ran a lot, we chaptered a lot of content ourselves and ran it through machine learning to understand what ends sentence or an idea or a phrase in these, and these, and try to find, and then the engine tries to automatically understand. In the range of audio cues that you find, you say there's something around here, try to find something that matches that. So we have a classifier for that. And we also take into consideration that the entry should be on an average of 3 to 5 minutes, okay? So even if I don't have anything, I will try to break it down. Even now, the author is talking about something 15 minutes, you don't have anywhere to stop, we'll force it. Because nobody has the 15 minutes. Yes,
I saw you. How do you handle different languages?
We don't currently. The logic is language agnostic. We have, one of our founders is a Japanese company that has in Japanese speech to text. They're called AMI. We've started with Japanese. We find a lot of correlation in what we do, but the text, the language is very different. We tested some things on German as well. We know that we're language agnostic, but building the models and finding out all the good sources to learn from, it's a costly, and we're a start. Give me a minute. Same question.
Just a really quick question, like, how do you kind of distinguish if it's, if like, let's say, like, maybe it's more about the data on the back end, but is it listening to, like, all different radio stations currently right now? Like, can you just listen all news is right now, like, kind of 24/7, like, endlessly?
Very good question. We are do not have the budget to listen to all the stations. We're listening to 50 live stations every hour. We have a schedule that runs and tries to find the best shows from that cover the entire U.S. and thousands of podcasts.
What if you get like a conflicting news story where like one news, you know, reports this, especially like if it's like left and right wing, like, you know, covering the same story.
So
like,
you'll get based on if their score of covering the topic is the same, you'll get both. Yes. Which one comes first? Probably the newer one. But one more thing that I didn't mention, which is very important. We have to take ads out. And that's one of the biggest challenges that we have, because the speaker, there are no jingles like there used to be, or you know that now they're on commercials. You have someone on the radio saying, and I just need my Coke right now. Where is it? I'm thirsty. And that's an ad. Okay, or the fact that they're talking about themselves all the time. So that's a lot of stuff that we had to clean up, and that's a totally huge INN-based classifier that learns how ads are behaved, because they're different. They're not a topic. They're a totally different type of content. Yes?
How do you weight everything? Because you're saying you create a score, but like, what is the... Can you go into any of that? Because like, they're saying like partisanship, but there's just also just issues of like, if you have the latest content, right? You're talking about streaming, like real-time content.
Yeah.
And you had like Google, for example, right? Like pull all this fake news and stuff like that from 4chan. How do you combat that kind of stuff? Because I imagine you can create a knowledge graph and say like, okay, CNN and, you know, Fox and all this other stuff have like higher rankings than like, say, Twitter, right? But like, how do you, at the same time, if you always want to give a result, you said that it fails sometimes. So how does it fail? What's the worst case scenario for
you? So worst case scenario is that we've asked about Apple and we got about someone talking about their Apple tree. Okay, that's because there was nothing that we had, but that was in the early days. We are now being
more popular, right?
Or, yeah, because no, not because there was nothing on Apple that week. Or when you ask about Facebook, you know, people are saying, you know, we are on Facebook, like us on Facebook. The word Facebook is mentioned so many times, but if you're actually looking for news, so that's on where we fail, and we keep understanding. But when you score a story, basically, if I know that this story needs to have, let's say about something about tax reform, I know that there needs to be the word GOP there. The Secretary of I don't know all the names, but I have a bunch of stuff that I need to have there because of what I read. That, you know, think about it as a word cloud. The word tax reform has a lot of words surrounding it, and their distance between how much GOP is strong with that, and for each of these terms we have, for each entity in the topics that we cover, we have a word cloud that says these are the things that needs to be there. Okay, and if they're there, and if I have a good start point and a good end point, and I have no ads, it gets a higher score.
But couldn't you just do, like, I mean, this is like SEO, you're right? Like, where you can just optimize around and figure out, like, reverse engineer how you're ranking this, right? And then I can get my story above somebody else, right? Especially if it's a hot topic, right? Like, I could surf around and figure out, like, okay, the shooting happened, and then, like, stream really good audio, and then you would pick it up, especially if it's the top. It's the latest thing.
If you're on the radio and that's what you do, I would love Audioburst to be SEO experts analyzing how we do what we do and pushing content for us. We'll this will be the best
it's
thing
just
for
like,
us.
I'm just saying it's possible, right? Just even with podcasts, right? Like, there's a way to
definitely
push
it's
content.
Possible. We have content ranking for content,
right?
And we're for news related stuff, radio wins, okay, over podcasts. Not technical, like technical stuff, podcast win, so it depends. So we have ranking on sources.
So sourcing rank, doesn't it?
Yes. So when we start, if you're asking something about the news, you remember,
right,
I mentioned which sources to pick. So
right,
if I know that you're asking about something that has to do with tax reform, I'll bring more stuff from the radio, although on weekends, I might do something different because weekends are totally different.
Right, yeah.
Okay. One last question.
Well, yeah.
Do you train your own entity vectors?
Yes, definitely.
And is that, are you predicting entity from context entities?
No, we're basically reading all these pages, and we have an entity engine that can extract what's the entity, what's the more important keywords, and then entities, find out if they're a person. Or we have a huge, we have 2.5 years of data that we've collected. So if you know, you mentioned IBM, do you know Alchemy by IBM? So they have a very good entity system, which you can, first of all, utilize and then learn for your own behavior. So we have, we're using Alchemy and our own, but our own has better scores on the topics, where there have, like, they can just tell you it's an entity.
So when you said you were using vectors, like a word vector model.
Okay, so word vector model is where we're talking about the word cloud. Okay, so now you have entities, and now you have your term. And now you need to see how, for each topic, what's the distance between an entity and your term.
Yes.
Okay, so think about it as a multi-dimensional vectors, where you can see on top, on topic, newest sports, the word GOP, it's not, it has a very, it's very far, but on a different vector, it's very close to the word hex.
Oh, I see. And you're basing that on Alchemy API.
Oh, the Alchemy is just for getting the entity, and then after that, we use our own for entity and score per topic. Okay. Per word.
And even your topics are.
We've decided what the topics are because we need to teach the engine something. So you need to let him know where to read. So let's say I don't have good on food, I'm very bad because I did not tell my engine, here are good RSS feeds that teach you about food. So if you ask what's the latest on hot dogs, you will not get a very good answer because we didn't learn. In order for me to give you a good answer, I need to be very educated on the topic. And on the other side, we have good sources to talk about hot dogs. Because if I don't, then I would never have an answer. So we analyze the sources, and based on the sources, analyze the topics. And I'm
sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I think the mic was dying before. Maybe we get a little more out of it. So Eric, you are out from this small company called Spotify, which I'm sure no one's heard of.
Hey guys, so I'm Eric. I'm from Spotify. I'm not going to talk about any Spotify stuff today because I did my graduate studies in New York, and today I wanted to have my academic hat on, and I was kind of really heartened to hear a lot of the really awesome questions that you guys are asking. So. If you'll indulge me, I want to get a little bit into the weeds because in addition to being a machine learning researcher at Spotify, I'm also a big music signal processing evangelist. So if you are really keen to like dig into TensorFlow or deep learning, like this is the talk that I want to like really get you guys excited about this stuff going forward. So let's jump right in. Okay, so I'm actually not going to talk about emotion whatsoever in this talk. I'm kind of like an AI curmudgeon. We can talk about that after. So in terms of listening to music audio, robust content description, you know, we've heard like semantics in terms of audio and text and images. But really, the ability to describe content automatically and at scale, it drives a number of different applications. You know, it could be consumption, like on the Spotify side, dissemination and curation, like an Audioburst, or creation on, you know, for Amper. And a lot of this rolls up into this field that's known as MIR, Music Information Retrieval. So a big question kind of comes into, how do we get this information out of our audio signals? So generally, where AI things are going to take the day is when you have automation. And what we mean by automation is automating someone who could do it themselves. So, you know, the story of Mechanical Turk, it was a human in a box. You can get really far in a finite amount of time by kind of throwing humans at the problem if you can make that scale. You pay them well. But the Music Genome Project, which Pandora really drove for a really long time, they were getting around 20 or 30 minutes for an expert musicologist to go through and rate popular music on hundreds of dimensions. Spotify has over 30 million songs. which for one person would be like over 1,000 years of just straight 24-hour listening of every weird esoteric track that, you know, has been added to our catalog. That's only really covering like a fraction of all commercial recordings. Content is growing exponentially, you know, as we have a lot of really great creator tools to accelerate the process of creation. Like, that's going to be a problem. We're also not really getting into the space of, you know, there's stuff uploaded constantly to YouTube, you know, there's spontaneous creation, on and on. This content explosion is real, and we need automatic algorithms to keep up. So, what ends up happening, though, is that a lot of what we've been able to leverage in, say, computer vision has manifested as a byproduct of, say, making web pages. If you have an image, you're going to, you know, build, write some text around that. You can leverage the text as labels for, you know, building machines to understand what's in the image. Understand. But this is going to kind of break down a little bit in the music description space, because we're not necessarily describing music content in high theoretical levels when we're listening to it. We're going to group things together so they sound similar, but we're not going through and marking like, oh yeah, this is the chorus. It'd be great if we knew where the chorus was in every song, but no one's actually doing that. And some of these things can be really, really time consuming for experts. You can take graduate courses in harmonic analysis, and these are really interesting things as we want to understand what is tension, what's expectation. Music. These are the things, all right, I lied. I mean, this is what really builds a lot of emotion in music. In the MR field for the last 10 or 15 years, you know, algorithms have kind of been tapering off a little bit. And a little while ago, there was this current concern that things were kind of slowing down. So here, I've just charted some progress for chord estimation, genre recognition, and mood estimation. So chord, genre, and mood. So you can kind of see the more abstract the test becomes, the worse off we're doing on these data sets. So there are kind of these three challenges that come out of music signal processing in this content-based MIR. There's a long tradition in signal processing, especially audio signal processing for handcrafted feature design. Shallow processing structures, they don't really capture this high-level information that we're trying to encode. And particular for audio and video, but we're not really there yet as a community, is we don't really have the best methods for coping with time. So you can kind of see where this is going. Deep learning, on the other hand, is you know, just knocking things over across the board. It's setting a lot of really great benchmarks across text and images and ASR. Plays Atari, it's beating world experts in Go, it's driving cars. Serving you bad news stories. And it's really great because it gives us this opportunity to have like deep representational power while having versatility for how we're designing these systems. So even in the music signal processing space, you know, we can build machine listening algorithms that are tackled with deep learning. So just kind of set the stage a little bit. I like to describe deep learning as just these two pieces. You have an architecture. It's just, Nando De Freitas has a really great analogy for, or another metaphor, for kind of relating deep learning to Legos. So the architecture or the structure that you're trying to build is just composed out of simple little blocks. You have a couple shapes, more every day with the way the research is going, but you have a couple building blocks. You're able to compose those into really interesting structures. And then the trick is, once you have this architecture, how do you find the parameters or the coefficients that get you the system that you want? And then you can kind of supplement this with a little, you know, tricks of the trade, the special sauce that actually makes some of these things work. So when I speak about processing architectures, that's just bad, right? Cool. So for processing architectures, we're generally talking about things that are like pretty basic linear algebra operations, matrix multiplication, convolutions, even the state-of-the-art stuff with recurrent nets is really. The matrix operation where you're processing a previous output, there isn't really anything all that crazy going on. There are various kinds of pooling operations, pointwise nonlinearities, and these are your, you know, your rectangles and your square building blocks you can stack them together. And as I'll show for a couple things a little bit later, you can leverage domain knowledge to build these things in ways where you can bake in knowledge about your problem to get things to behave in really correct ways. So what do we mean by learning? this is where I'm going to put on my grandpa hat for a second and take it off my lawn. In machine learning and a lot of this stuff, it's really about using greedy optimization algorithms to just find good parameters. Like, learning is a nice metaphor, but really what we're doing is searching a super complex space. So given an objective function, we're really just trying to say, how do we find the right coefficients that make this thing behave the right way? Gradient methods work really well. Jeff Hinton has said that the most surprising thing about gradient methods is that we just underestimated how long they would take and how much data they would need. This is really just greedy hill climb, or greedy hill climbing or descent. So given data, you can throw a bunch of it at. What are tricks of the trade? For the longest time, this has been regularization, dropout, ensemble methods, taking a bunch of different models and just averaging their outputs. One works really well, but statistically what you're doing is decreasing the variance of your error. This is actually how you can hack a lot of Kaggle competitions, which is partly what makes it a little bit frustrating. A lot of time and effort has been spent on how do I pick the parameters? Random initialization works great if you have a ton of data. What happens if you don't? Can you kind of warm start these models given a large corpus, say millions of hours of audio? Recently, things like data augmentation have gotten really far, especially for computer vision. There are platforms that are building this kind of thing directly into their pipelines. What kind of data augmentation could you use for music? Should genre be tempo invariant? Well, maybe that doesn't make sense if you're talking about a tango. You can introduce different constraints, and I'll show that in a bit. There are fun architectural hacks that you can do to kind of get recursion to work. LSTMs are a version of this. Recurrent models are nice. They have a vanishing gradient problem. LSTMs kind of use more parameters to latch some of this behavior. And then you can also have metastructures where you compose systems of systems. I'll show one kind of old now example of that. But GANs kind of fit into this. You're having these different differentiable models that you can stack together given one objective function and train all of it at the same time, approximately. Okay, so what I want to talk about just quickly to kind of whet your appetite for what you can dig into. Yes?
Do you use grid search on steroids like H2O? H2O?
I'm personally a fan of things like HyperOpt, okay. Where like if you can build a distribution over your hyperparameters. We can dig into that later afterwards if you're really curious.
Talk a lot about
machine learning algorithms and parametric
theory,
but you
have
mentioned that how your extract information features from the audio. So I know that because I'm doing computer vision, I know you can just drop when you make into the neural network. I'm going to show a picture of that right now.
Okay,
thank you. All right, cool. And by right now, I mean like two or three slides, because I'm not really familiar with the order. Okay, so first off, just timbre. Timbre is a really interesting one, kind of ease our way in. Timbre is a relatively low-level attribute of sound, which we know nothing about. It's been referred to as the psychoacoustician's wastebasket. The actual definition in the books for timbre is that quality of sound that's left over when you hold duration, pitch, and loudness constant. So it's kind of this definition by exclusion, which makes it a really interesting thing to study using data. There aren't really absolute descriptors of timbre. You can say, that trumpet sounds muddy, that guitar sounds bright. A lot of these are in culture. They don't really mean anything absolutely. So we can kind of look at how things sound as a function of similarity. And to dig into this a little bit, we can use instrument taxonomies as a proxy. As Drew mentioned earlier, there are like huge sample libraries that we can leverage. You can kind of assume that all drum sounds should sound like drums, all trumpets should sound like trumpets. Can we use all this data to kind of tease out a manifold or a space that these sounds kind of look in? So a lot of the tradition for music signal processing uses some kind of time frequency input. In this case, I believe it's a constant Q. Constant Q is a time frequency representation that's linear in pitch. So it's kind of like a piano. The distance between notes is kind of like if you were sitting down at a keyboard, which makes it really nice for convolutional neural networks. Your pitch transpositions are linear. So here what we're going to do is try to learn an embedding, this low dimensional Z, where if we have two sounds that are similar, we're going to try to push them together. If we have two sounds that are dissimilar by some definition, we're going to try to push them apart. In this case, the similarity is, they're all saxophones. This is a saxophone, that's a trumpet. It's a multi-layer comp net. The architecture itself isn't really that important, but what's interesting is that you're sharing these parameters across this. You have this pairwise training objective. And this is kind of like an audio version of what happens with word to vector. So you can think of this contrastive sampling as a way of learning a model that can then project new inputs into this four-dimensional space. I'll just quickly burn through a little bit of methodology. The Vienna Symphonic Library is this really massive library of sound fonts. Here, we just filter it down to 24 total instruments. We're looking at a couple different subset configurations to see how instruments kind of crowd the space. And then you can compare it against a slightly simpler, LDA supervised, but a simpler representation. So you'll see here, there's like, in this C5 or five instruments category, you have tuba, oboe, clarinet, cello, and flute. Vienna Symphonic Library is German, which is why you have the abbreviations as they are. So you can kind of see how these get stacked together. C8 is interesting because it kind of pairs a couple similar timbres. So trumpet and horn, oboe and English horn are both double reeds. Clarinet and saxophone are both single reeds, violin and cello are both strings. And I just said all those things. Great. So when you do this, you can kind of see that just based on numbers, it's really preserving the structure and the data. This is a nearest neighbor kind of classifier. So you're saying like the nearest data point is actually the sound sample that you're looking for. It's really the only takeaway here. But it's interesting if you look at where some of these confusions start to fall. If it were perfect, you'd get 90 or 100s across the diagonal. But we don't really want a perfect classifier. What we're actually trying to look for is this space where if I said, what's the interpolating point between a trumpet and a saxophone, you could actually search those timbres maybe visually. So here you'll see trumpet and horn, tuba and horn. We're getting some brass confusions. Similar things happen for reeds. But what it looks like is you have this space where, is I going to draw it now? Great. So here you can see clarinet, oboe, and cello. They kind of organize around. The other two are implicit. Colors get a little bit dense. But as you start to add more instruments into this space, you can kind of see it organizing. Kind of T-SNE style, if you're familiar with the stochastic neighbors embedding. The difference here is that this is actually projecting the input audio. Something like T-SNE is a mapping from a collection of inputs into a space. It doesn't generalize new inputs. You could then run this over, you know, any song that comes out of Amper or whatever you want in there. And you can kind of see how these instruments move around space. Great. The takeaway being here, you can kind of dig into how timbre interacts. You can use this for visualization, searching, indexing. But it also creates a really interesting opportunity to explore how timbre gets used. And right now, these are short sound samples. They're about a second. You can imagine looking at how timbre evolves over time. Maybe this is a way to visualize a waveform in a audio workstation. You could use it for composition. Kind of just scratching the surface a little bit. So if you're interested, I'll have a link at the end. A lot of this code is online. You can go home and play with a lot of this stuff yourself. Okay, that's a nice little entry point. I'm a guitarist. I got into all audio signal processing stuff because I wanted to make guitar pedals. I got into machine learning stuff because I wanted machines to show me how to play songs on guitar. This is also a problem that is worked on inside the MIR community. And you know, this is compete.com is now dead. But websites like Ultimate Guitar, like they're attracting millions of users a month. And be really great if they weren't limited to the 800,000 tracks that they have. So how can you do this with a neural net? So we're gonna take, again, this constant Q input, and here we're actually gonna bake in a little bit of knowledge about chords. So in a chord, we can safely assume that, say, all majors should share some kind of similar structure, regardless of what the root is. And what we can do is, in this last layer, actually factor this out and make a root quality invariant representation that allows us to say, you know, all majors should have the same representation horizontally, but we're going to encode root on this vertical axis. So we can use that convolution, flatten it, and then we'll get our chord likelihood out from a confident. So using this data set of around 1,200 tracks, we're actually going to do a pretty large scale chord estimation task. As you can expect, a lot of things are major minor. It's a pretty bad power law, so it's really hard to predict these long tail chords, things like diminished 7, half diminished 7. But where a lot of the emotion and tension is going to come from is in these really interesting, generally dissonant chords. Okay, so there are two ways to kind of benchmark how well this thing is doing. We can look at this measure called weighted recall, which is how well does it do as just a function of total time. And then quality-wise recall, how well is it doing over the different chord qualities, major, minor, major 7, minor 7, dominant 7. And what this is telling us is how well does it do across the chord qualities, kind of regardless of how well represented they are in the data set. So we throw some neural nets at it, we get some pretty on par state-of-the-art results, kind of catching up to 15 years of research by using a deep network. And we're able to actually get an improvement on the quality-wise recall as well. In the time since this work was done, a colleague of mine at NYU has since surpassed this. His work is awesome. If you're familiar with Librosa, he's the developer on that, I would recommend everyone check it out. Okay, so we've been able to build pretty quickly a deep learning system that can do chord estimation. I'm going to have some demos of what this actually looks like in a little bit. There's an interesting trade-off here that we've kind of danced around. It's that, you know, I mentioned it here, that this how well a system does over time is kind of tied to how well it can represent these different long-tail chords. And as you can expect, this is kind of a function of subjectivity. And we'll see what that looks like shortly. But we still haven't gotten to the thing that I want, which is, you know, we have these chord shapes, but it's outputting C, G7, A minor. If you're good, you could imagine this being written in common Western music notation. I used to read treble clef when I played saxophone. I'm a lazy guitarist now, I just want the tabs. If you've ever picked up a guitar, you probably do too. But what's really nice is that if we could actually get a representation that produced this directly, we're already predicting into a representation that could be easily fixed. Like, I could play this directly, I could say, you know, it's not this dot, it's this dot. Because a lot of the errors that the system is making, it's pretty at the root, but it's kind of losing out on telling the difference between, say, like a triad or a three-note chord versus a tetrad or a four-note chord. So now what we're going to do is use domain knowledge to influence this architecture, and what we're going to do is define, in this case, 157 different chord templates. I'm trying to go back on this. So we have a very similar model. What we're going to do is we're going to build a classifier over each string. So here you can imagine this is, I think, a G or a C sharp, made 7 minor. This is a G sharp minor. So here, anytime the string is going to be off, that's going to be in the first position, and then we'll say these should all be on. So now we have 6 parallel classifiers over each string. I'm just picking a single template for each chord. Create some really interesting things as you start to decode this over time. This is kind of like a first attempt at saying, how can you produce automatic tablature from audio? You'll see we're still operating on this constant cue input. It's about 5 seconds in context. And we're trying to predict the chord that's active in the middle. Cool. When we do this, we get really awesome results. You know, if you do it just with the data as is, that's fine. If we introduce data augmentation, here what we can do is say, I'm going to pseudo pitch shift my input. And change the chord label. So we're able to get some slightly better results there. More quality-wise stuff, we kind of lose a little bit here because of how the model's trained. But we're still pretty much around state-of-the-art. But what's interesting is this is what I was talking about for, this is the target that the model is trying to predict for an input. Here, it's kind of on the boundary between a flat 7 and the octave, so it's kind of close. Technically, this is wrong. And the nearest template says it's a dominant 7. So this kind of illustrates like when the model's wrong, it's kind of close, and that's an easier thing to fix. So this idea that humans in the loop makes for a really interesting way to bootstrap these algorithms that are okay but not perfect. And this is what we've all been waiting for. So what does this actually look like when you run it over audio?
I got my first real 6-string. Oh, you have to five and dime. Played it till my fingers bled. Was the summer of 69. Years and guys from school had a band and we tried real hard.
So you might have seen those white dots that are in there. Like when I put this together, I was trying to play along with it, and I was like, "All right, where's it going next?" So that those white dots are just kind of like a little bit of a look ahead, so it's a little bit more usable. You saw a couple dots kind of bounce and skip a little bit in there, but you can imagine saying like, "All right, we can easily kind of correct this representation." So with this, we're able to push the state of the art, at least catch up to it very quickly by using data. Playability and discriminability of chords might kind of be at odds. I'm going to show what that means shortly. But it allows us to get directly to a chord representation that doesn't require this extra decoding step or musical knowledge or higher education. And it facilitates correction and feedback. Okay, so, but we didn't ace automatic chord estimation. That's an acronym joke. So can we figure out kind of what was happening? Well, what ends up happening is the data, you know, garbage in, garbage out. I'm not saying this is a Beatles song. I'm not saying the Beatles are garbage. However, not all content is well described by chords. But similarly, how would you transcribe a song like this?
Here comes a rock on the wall. Tell me, mirror, what is wrong?
I mean, his De La Soul song is awesome, but I do not know how I play that on guitar. You have to comp something or make something up, and it creates a really interesting opportunity for, you know, machine creativity and kind of arrangements, but arrangements are not chord recognition. So kind of doing some of these things kind of elucidates the challenges that are inherent to it. I will play this one. This is actually where there's a little bit of an assumption that when you're doing chord recognition, everyone's tuned to A440. This is actually tuned to 427. So because you're kind of at a boundary point, both models are actually a little bit more precise and being like, no, it's E flat major, when the transcription was at G major. So you have this kind of 12-tone equal temperament invalidation. Is this one? I like this one. Not only for the song, but kind of what this means when we think about like subjectivity and music.
Average sounds like you easily.
So the relationship between a major chord and a dominant seventh is a flat seven being added on top.
I'll take all the blame.
So here you're seeing the model track the flat 7 when the cello plays it. But what's going on here is these are actually two different human annotations. So this is Davey Temperley and Trevor DeClerc. Trevor was a PhD student faculty at the Eastman, which is a great music school. And they went through this exercise of having both of them do chord transcriptions over popular rock songs. And they disagreed because, you know, Trevor, who's a guitarist, he was like, no, this flat 7, it's kind of persisting through the entire verse. And Davey was like, that's major. The guitarist is playing major, it doesn't really matter to me. Paraphrasing, I'm not putting words in Davey's mouth. But where this gets really gnarly is if you have this situation where these are all human annotators. You can see through kind of the different shades of color that all the chords that share a root are in the same shade, or rather hue. So all the blues are the same root, and the shades kind of tell you where the different qualities are. So you're getting a lot of disagreement even between the humans. The best matching machine annotation to human is around like 89 or 90%. The worst matching one is something like point something. So it can really matter who you're picking as ground truth. and just because the music's fun.
1, 2, 3, 4! Well, you were just 17, did you know what I mean? And the way she looked was way beyond the man. So how could I land with another? Oh, when I saw her standing there.
You can actually see that in this one, the deep network actually tracks the bass moving through the flat 7 in that chromatic motion, whereas a human had called it an inversion. So it's picking up the same pitch classes, but spelling things are a little bit differently. In the chord, kind of like guitar tab thing, that'll all just wash out. Okay, so all music is necessarily well described by chords, and this is really, really an interesting thing to think about as we kind of get to that next evolution of what music's going to be in the 21st century. Like, is a Rihanna chord transcription really the song, or is it all of the production and the timbre of her voice and kind of like all of these other things that don't necessarily map well to what we think of as Western music notation? Kind of in the weeds, how we evaluate these systems isn't necessarily linking with how you might use them, say if you're a guitarist. And this kind of competing goal of recognition and transcription, it's kind of conflated in the data. So getting systems out and getting feedback from users is a really good way to kind of clean some of these things up. And especially in music, this notion of ground truth can be really tenuous. Even something as simple as like, I'm playing this on piano versus I'm playing this on guitar, you might voice a chord entirely differently because you can't play that on guitar. But on piano, you can play all 5 adjacent notes. So, before I stop talking and allow you to get some fresh air and maybe some Spotify stickers that I've brought, I'll be asking questions. There'll be a pop quiz to see how much you were paying attention. Deep learning is a super powerful way to tackle these high-level intelligent problems, but really it allows us to kind of accelerate the research cycle. You can think about deep learning as kind of being this data-driven compiler. It's still spitting out bytecode. So when we call it a black box, you know, your binary executables are black boxes too. It's just about what dials and knobs you've given it. We can also go through and revisit old problems and kind of tackle some new ones that don't even have data yet. But for music, there's a lot of things that we can do by kind of taking the lessons from computer vision or natural language processing and map them over to music. But domain knowledge is still going to be really important to kind of push that field much further. So it's about formulating the right question. You know, is chords the right language for this task? Architecting a good solution. What do we know about music harmony and music theory? And then understanding what a good system is, because you could just spend a lot of time trying to optimize these measures and not be making meaningful progress. So kind of digging into what the systems are doing is like the most important thing. And with that, I say thanks. Thanks so much for bossing me. If you are interested in music signal processing, either as a weekend project or you're considering doing, a class project or following along with Coursera and you want to tinker with stuff, there's a lot of really great work on ismir.net. That's the International Society for Music Information Retrieval. All of the proceedings are public. And the community has gotten really great about both sharing code and being responsive on the listserv. A lot of the code that I shared is available here. I apologize for its state in advance, but I'm really responsive on GitHub, and you can harass me on Twitter or ask me questions. Questions, Sam?
Where can I get that slide?
Which one?
The slide you just used.
The guitar thing?
Yes.
That demo is up on YouTube somewhere. So if you can find me on YouTube, you can go look at that.
All right. Awesome.
How important is the quality of the file that you're studying? And, just in general, when thinking about compression, losing detail, artifacts that might be introduced, what problems are you trying to solve? Where do you break down?
So I have two answers to that. One, a lot of what we, especially for like the chord stuff, fundamental pitch tops out pretty low, So you don't need the highest sampling rate. You can kind of use that as a nice gain in efficiency. And we're going to downsample everything to mono, like 8,000 kilohertz or 8,000 hertz. You know, it's going to cause some problems, like with all the music that was produced when stereo was new. So Jimi Hendrix, Purple Haze, his voice is in one channel. Like, he's not even center. Or like the Beatles did a lot of really crazy production effects, so that's going to break. But audio quality is also a really interesting opportunity for data augmentation. Because if you can, you know, downsample your signal and throw it through a bunch of different codecs and add white noise and, you know, really wreck your signal and still get the perception out, you can make it robust to that while also having a system that isn't going to fall over when it steps on those kinds of things. So it's a little bit twofold there.
So I have a little bit of background in image processing using ConvNets, but not anything with audio files. So is there a big difference? I mean, like, do I still need the XP Titan GTX card for audio stuff?
Yeah.
For GPUs, that you need as many as possible.
If you're doing convolutions, GPUs are great. Convolutions can take you pretty far in the audio space. One of the greatest challenges, I think, for kind of like machine listening is music is actually a graph. Like, we know this with like, oh, I'm gonna take the first repeat and then I'll take the second ending, or I have a DSL coda. Like, you actually have these wormholes in structure and repetitions and linking and stuff that we don't, even when you think of a recurrent net, we're not thinking about recurrent nets as being cyclical. So they're really good for sequences that are kind of pooling behavior on different timescales, but these other things don't work. So that's kind of like one of those nuances. But for things like, you know, there's an awesome intern project from Sandra Dielman, who's now at DeepMind, which still gets cited like crazy for work that he did at Spotify, and that's all ConvNets. Works great. Mm-hmm. So when you're doing like scene description or kind of things that are musically related to the acoustic signal, ConvNets take the day. If you need any kind of like squishiness in time, recurrent nets are nice because they'll figure out what that is. And you can kind of think of like nonlinear pooling, like max pooling, is kind of giving you some of that for free. Or any kind of pooling is going to give you a little bit of temporal squishiness.
Well, that's good to know. Is this the best place to start? Like, if you're going to start looking into audio as opposed to images, or the
best place to start
somewhere else?
I'm biased. I am very heavily involved in this community, but all the publications are free. You don't need an account with some publisher or aggregator. We are fundamentally open source, so you can go through and just. We just had a conference a couple weeks ago in Suzhou in China. Those proceedings will be up. They're already up online on the conference website. They'll be up on the main site soon. There's a lot of stuff in there, and everyone's gotten really great about sharing code. I would say that if you're curious to get started with music signal processing, check out a library called Librosa.
Librosa?
Yeah.
Librosa?
Nailed it.
And last question, just as I've heard that pooling is somewhat moving out of style for images, you know, there's more of this YOLO, you only look once approach. Would that apply for audio, or is pooling still very important?
I mean, pooling is a really nice hack. Like, it gets you a lot of computational efficiency for not a lot of effort. Mm-hmm. Pooling kind of, it breaks down when you're doing any kind of generative stuff, because you, all of that great blurring that you're introducing to make up for that, you then lose when you're going backwards through your model. So for doing any kind of like classification or description stuff, like, pooling's still fine. It's when you want to start synthesizing. Like, there's been some neat stuff that folks have started doing with style transfer and audio. But that's where like knowing some digital signal theory can really help get good sounding audio back. Because one of the things that we're throwing away here is this notion of phase. So you're keeping your magnitude spectra. And I can't really say more about that without like a whiteboard. But there's really important information that's being discarded already in these representations. So pulling some.
That's helpful. I'll tweet it to you.
So how easily can you pull apart when there's two violins playing different music? Right? Can it literally pull them out aside? Like, all right, no, this is the first violin, this is the second violin.
Okay, so there are two things there. There's being able to identify it in the mix, which is like stream segregation, and then there's stream separation. So source separation is that holy grail of like, I have two signals, I mix them together, and then I get them both back. whereas stream segregation is you could be in a crowded room, I could still hear what you're saying, although my brain isn't necessarily like making the rest of the room fall away. So I can still attend to what's going on. Segregation is much, much easier, especially for doing like what instruments are active in sound recording, especially when it comes to something like voice, which tends to be very salient and forward in the mix. That may fall over when you end up in a different distribution, say like jazz. That totally answered.
So it sounds like you can use it as far as pulling data from it, but actually separating the music, like, I want to mute every violin except for this one.
It's hard because another surprising thing about psychoacoustics is that we don't necessarily have the best objective measures for when something sounds good. So if you're trying to say, make this signal sound like this signal, when they're perfect, it's trivial. You're like, oh yeah, I have zero error. But kind of in that in-between, something with low error can sound terrible, and something with a higher error could be a little bit more pleasing. Mm. So the lack of a good objective measure of perceptual audio quality is a huge block for a lot of synthesis stuff right now.
Just to expand on that, is that kind of where the difficulty of this problem is, as opposed to say like computer vision, is that like there's a difficulty with defining like what is the objective function, what are you optimizing, or even like you were talking about timbre where you're saying it's more of an exclusion as opposed to like defining exactly what that is. So is that more, I don't know enough about this at all, but it just sounds like when you're working through this problem, it sounds like there's a lot of difficulty with defining terms or defining what am I optimizing around, mm-hmm. and then build, how do I build the models? Because if you don't even have the parameters to build off of, what do you, you know, there's kind of a, what's the base truth that you're going to build off of, right?
Yeah. I would say there are two challenges that face machine listening for music in particular.
Sure.
One, a lot of these things that we think of as being good or interesting tasks don't have data at scale. Like, ImageNet has been even MNIST was an amazing, amazing thing for computer vision. But it was also, MNIST was 60,000 labeled images. There were 28 by 28 pixels,
yeah.
and each of the pixels was 8-bit.
Right.
So the amount of data needed to process some of this content at a higher resolution, it kind of creates this problem. And there aren't necessarily compelling reasons why that data would have been generated. Like a lot of MNIST was produced for like check reading.
Right.
And there isn't really that same, let's say, economic drive behind a lot of music analysis and listening.
Yeah.
The other one that makes it really interesting, and you know, we were talking about like metaphysical aspects of music. If you have an image of the natural world, that image exists whether or not humans do.
Yeah.
Music only exists because humans do.
Yeah.
And not only does it only exist because humans, but a human put it together. Or, well, for now. and there's a lot of intentionality that goes into that.
Right.
So every recorded music artifact right now has this layer of intentionality and intelligence baked into it in a way that a lot of natural images don't. Which is why it's really exciting that a lot of the style transfer stuff has started looking at like Picasso, or other kind of classic paintings and style. From a content side, that's really, really interesting.
Fantastic presentation. I'm admittedly uneducated in this subject. So how does this affect our Discover Weekly or our Time Capsule, which is scary on the money in terms of nailing kind of what I listened to 10 years ago?
I will send that feedback back to the folks at Spotify. It's really interesting. Like a lot of recommender systems have gotten very, very far with things that are loosely collaborative filtering based. Which as an audio guy, I'm like, but if you think about it, like what's really going on is that all these collaborative filtering things, I mean, we're open about it, like we use playlists and we have 2 billion of them. So because humans have made a lot of conscious decisions about these things go in this list and these things go in this list, it's actually, humans are really, really awesome high-level feature extractors. It's like, you know, the like don't spend time building an automatic system for something you can solve with humans. Like, everyone wants a job, and you'll solve it in finite time. You may never solve a research problem. So it works out that, like, you get really, really far if you have the data. The audio stuff, it factors into the cold start problem. Like, what happens if a new artist drops on Spotify and they haven't been in a playlist yet? That's where you start to run into these kind of challenges, where machine listening can also help kind of pick things up.
So you talked a lot about detecting each individual instrument and then sort of transposing what chords they're playing. Do you think in our lifetimes we would ever see a software application that can listen to a song and then chart out every instrument?
I mean, there are some things that already kind of do that. One piece of software that comes to mind is called Melodyne. You can go in and you can kind of rework, like, I played this guitar note wrong, I want to just move it up to be in the right.
Well, I'm saying, like, you play a Beatles song, and it says, the bass is doing this, the guitar is doing this, the other guitar is doing that, this is what the piano is doing, this is what the drum is doing, automatically. Do you think that that would ever be possible in our lifetime?
Yeah. I think we have the methods. What we're lacking is the data. Like, that's one of the most amazing things about this. Like, I did a chord recognition stuff with 1,200 tracks. Like, some of the data sets that are being used, like, you know, ImageNets, like, we're getting these really amazing, like, image description systems, because they're leveraging, you know, what's ImageNet now, millions of things? Or, like, the NVIDIA work recently with the celebrity face morphing with the progressive learning of GANs. It's a huge corpus. So it's really interesting to think about, like, well, if we had that data, could we solve a problem? What are the problems actually, and how much of it is a data scarcity issue? So, okay, CJ, and then I'll let everyone get up.
last year at Izmir, Google was training a generative music net, and the loss function was predicting collaborative filtering embeddings. Do you think that's a bad approach? Given your opinion of how much music description is in a collaborative.
No, I mean, I think it makes a lot of sense, because kind of what you're saying is humans have organized all this content in a very intentional way, and there's some structure in that data, and if you're able to recover that either through some kind of like latent matrix factorization or by training a model to kind of predict into that, I think it's still useful. I think the thing that we maybe get away from a little bit with a lot of the deep learning stuff is, when is a model doing a thing versus when is a model useful? And if they become building blocks inside of larger systems, like, yeah, that's actually good enough to bootstrap a, you know, search and retrieval system that I can then use as a startup to actually get some users who can then, you know, quickly tell me that's not actually what they want. So to what extent can we kind of get far enough to get into this virtuous cycle of users improving systems? Like, I think that is the most exciting part of machine learning right now. We've done a lot of stuff in academic labs that's this one shot, like, I had data, I built a system, it did X. Okay, now I'm gonna try a new algorithm. I trained on this data, I built a system, and it did X. It's like, okay, well, what if that system that did X then went and got used by humans, and then it did a different thing, and then you either updated it through reinforcement learning, or you actually expanded the amount of data that you had, or it predicted different data entirely. And how can we have more of a, not only incremental in method, but incremental in system approach to some of these ML things.
What then would be your favorite way of using MAR to generate music?
So I think what's really, really interesting is that there's actually been a big shift recently for kind of like creative purposes or creative ML for, say, like music generation or whatnot. And I kind of come back a little bit to this idea where it's like, you know, what's the worst case scenario? Like, if you had like monkeys writing Shakespeare, they had infinite time and infinite more, like infinite monkeys, you actually want them to write Shakespeare, right? And it's kind of like that Ira Glass quote, like, the trick is knowing when you've written Shakespeare. Right? Because it's huge, but there is actually a finite number of MIDI files you could produce. And if you had, say, a massive server farm and you just produced like 8 billion MIDI files, one of them's probably okay, especially if you use some structure or other data to build systems that's producing realistic outputs, like, the devil's in picking the right one. Because I'm an okay songwriter, but I'm determined as hell. So I'm not necessarily writing good stuff first, but because I continue to hack at it, I'm like, oh no, this is actually the thing that I would have written had I known to write it in the first place. So there's an interesting space for, and this is why GAN's really exciting for creation, like in this actor-critic model. I think someone already did an Ira GAN or something like that. For those that don't know, the Ira Glass quote is something like, being creative when you're young is hard because you have good taste, but you aren't skilled yet. So hang in there, you'll get better at being creative, but your taste is solid and that's why it hurts. So it's really interesting to think about that and kind of like this duality of creation and evaluation. I'll stop now.